Thank you, Frans. Okay, I try to make, I think you had a long day, and I tried to make it as quick as possible, but I don't want to miss anything. So if you have any questions, just shout and interrupt me. I will begin with a short introduction to EEG microstates. So EEG microstates are not really the classical way how people look at EEG data. In the classic way, EEG is typically looked at single electrodes or a selection of electrodes. There, people look at evoked event-related potentials, so what happens after a stimulus or some event, what happens to this signal. Or they look at the frequency distribution over time, or they look at both so-called time frequency and so-called time frequency analysis. As I said, all these techniques, they typically select some electrodes and do their analysis on these electrodes. In the past probably 10, 20 years, there has been a huge development in EEG hardware, and with this, high-density EEG systems became more and more popular, so we're talking about more than 200 electrodes on the skull. So this brings us to a problem, namely the problem which electrodes should be looked at. And with this problem, this gives us also the freedom to choose those electrodes who give us the strongest effects. So it might be tempting to just do some cherry picking, and on the other side, if you do it properly, you have the problem of multiple testing. A second problem with just looking at single electrodes is that we miss on a lot of this rich data, which is in EEG. So an alternative way of looking at EEG or EEG signals is to think about EEG as a system of states with dynamics. And states can be many different things. For example, a state can be described by the complexity of the EEG signal. So there are studies who look at how easily EEG data can be compressed, so how much compression is in there, which is a related measure to complexity. We can look at synchronicity. And with all these different descriptions about the states, we can look at how they change over time. So we can look at the dynamics. In microstates, we look at the topography of the EEG data. And I want to explain what I mean by this, the EEG topography. We have seen it in the task before. Nikos, he has also shown some topography pictures. I just want to quickly show what it really means for those who are not familiar with it. So if you look at the EEG data, it consists of electrodes, the number of electrodes, which is recorded over time. And a single time point on this graph can be translated in a topography, which is the same idea as a landscape map. So in EEG topographies, we typically color these topographies, and I don't know, by some convention, red usually means positive polarity, and blue a negative polarity. And the strength of the intensity of the color sort of shows where the peaks are. So if we look at topographies of a time series, then we can either look at changes in the configuration of the topography. This tells us something about changes in the activity of the underlying networks. So the main assumption about the topography is that some neural generators produce this topography. On the other hand, we can also look at difference in the amplitude, which translates into changes of the strength of coherently active neurons. So a topographical analysis describes the dynamics of the functional states of neuron networks. So now to the sort of the birth of EEG microstates. I don't exactly know which study discovered microstates, but probably one of the earliest ones was by Dietrich Lehmann, who used to be a professor here in Zurich. He observed, or his passion was to look at EEG topographies, and in this study in 1987, he looked at a resting state or resting EEG, and he found that the EEG topography doesn't change randomly. It's not that from time point topographies change. No, they stay stable for a couple of some tenths of milliseconds, typically between 80 and 150 milliseconds, and then they switch rapidly into other configurations. So his idea was, or based on this, he thought that these spatially stationary segments might be the basic building blocks of brain information processing. And he was thinking about that this could also be associated with the meaning of or our consciousness about time, how we feel time, and many other interesting ideas. What's next? So to analyze this, or this gave sort of the opportunity to reduce the complexity of EEG. So you could think about sort of microstates. That means the EEG or the brain is over a certain time in quasi-stable state. And many other studies have looked at this, especially in spontaneous EEG. And what has been found is that the topography, or that the EEG can be, or no, that a lot of the variance in the EEG, around 80% of the variance of the EEG, can be described with only very few microstate classes, or can be described with very few different topographies. So here I wrote typical four microstates. It depends. I mean, it's between four and eight. It really depends on sort of also on the tradition where the people come from. And what has also been found is that these microstates, that they typically last between 80 and 120 milliseconds. And this is this reflects about the speed of information processing in distinct brain areas, as shown in other studies. So now to the basic steps of a microstate analysis. So as we've seen before, first we need clean data, so we need pre-processing. I'm not going to cover this again, but the first step in the microstate analysis is to segment the EEG into microstates. So the goal of the microstate segmentation is to find prototypical topographies. So we are looking for very few prototypical topographies which explain a lot of the EEG. Sometimes they're called microstate classes, prototype maps, there are many different names for it, and I'll probably switch from time to time. So, if we have done this, there's typically the step of backfitting. So often we do the segmenting on high signal-to-noise data, and we are looking for the best topographies there, and then we backfit it to sometimes to single trial data or to average data. So this is the backfitting. And here the goal is to label the data, so we can label each time point with the microstate class that correlates best. And in the end, we're interested about the dynamics of the microstates. I call this microstate statistics. So we can then, for every type of microstate, calculate different parameters of interest. I'm going to show you some in the tutorial later. And in the end, of course, if we want to write papers, we do some statistics.
Yeah.
I have a question. If I understood it correctly, you have some predefined microstates and you're trying to find out to which microstate a specific segment of a specific subject belongs to.
Mm-hmm.
How do you define those microstates?
So the microstates, so the thing is, you have like these prototypical maps.
Are those?
And they are, you get them out of the microstate segmentation. So this is typically done with k-means clustering. So you sort of look for the topography, for the most prominent topographies in the EEG.
For each subject, separate?
You can do it differently.
Okay.
I'm gonna talk about this a little bit in the tutorial. There are many. Yeah, that's another thing. Because microstates analysis is not really, it's a bit not the classical analysis. There are many ways to do it. And one thing about which was also a motivation for this EEG Lab toolbox was to make all these steps really visible. Because if you use other software, I'm not saying names, they're red. Sometimes you don't really know what the details are. And here in MATLAB, the nice thing is you can really go into the code and see what happens there. So if we do a microstate analysis, we have to think about the data, or we have to check whether our data reflects spontaneous data, that is really ongoing EEG signal, or whether we have averaged it. In terms of event-related data. If you use spontaneous data, and we will use spontaneous data in this tutorial, we have to ignore the polarity of the topographies. This is because it also has been observed that in spontaneous EEG, the polarity often switches, but not the topography, from time point to time point. So, and this is interpreted that the networks which are active, they oscillate in positive and negative polarities. And this is different in event-related data. And for spontaneous data, we use k-means, and there's a special version of k-means of Pascal Marquis. And we're going to use this. So, and this modified k-means algorithm ignores polarity, simply. And what is also a special thing in spontaneous EEG data, to segment the data, we typically use global field power peaks. The global field power is simply the standard deviation of the EEG potential across the electrodes. And this measure just tells you how strong activity is over the whole scalp. And the idea behind taking the GFP peaks is that at the points where GFP is high, there's a strong activity in the brain, and the signal has a higher signal-to-noise ratio. So we can use this to clean our data. In event-related data, we also need clean data, but there we do it by averaging over multiple trials. So I think I've said most of this, but here again as an overview. So first, in the segmentation, we aim to find the most prototypical topographies on the data. In spontaneous EEG, we use GFP peaks. We use typically,
sorry, just if I understand the microstates, just go back. They're temporally independent, so if it waits for a certain period of time, I have one microstate.
Exactly, they are exclusive.
Yeah,
so the microstates analysis assumes that it only can be one microstate at a time. There are newer versions of it, which the guys in Denmark are working on, which allow some
dependency.
Yeah, probabilistic microstates. But this is science fiction for the moment. So we use a modified Keynes clustering. I'm not going into details how this works, but yeah, it's sort of a data reduction method. And there's a very difficult question we have to ask ourselves. And this is, we have to tell the clustering algorithm how many clusters we want. For getting a good answer, there are criteria, like we can do cross-validation. There are other more appropriate criteria, but they all have some weaknesses. So this is, for me, this is really a weak spot on the whole microstate analysis. This hasn't been solved fully yet. So in spontaneous EEG, many people just choose four microstates, because it has been done many times. And we will do as well in the tutorial, because it doesn't take so long. So, and in the back fitting, as I said, we want to assign the microstate classes with the highest spatial correlation, so which are the most similar to the topography of each time frame. And there in parentheses, I have with the minimum segment duration. And this is also an important detail, because we can think about, if you look at this segment here, if we don't say that it has to have a minimum segment duration, it would insert a second microstate on the transition between the topographies. So if topographies switch, you have a moment of very low signal-to-noise ratio and a chaotic topography. And then it happens often that you get any microstate which is closest to this. And we want to avoid this. So there is some option which says, okay, a microstate has to be at least 10 milliseconds long or something like this. So now to these microstate statistics, I have just just name a few. So typically we calculate the average duration of microstates. So that looks really, let's say we have four microstates, and for each microstate I see how long it is on average. We can count how often a microstate occurs, for example, in a second. And the third parameter, which is related, or sort of the product of the two, is the percentage of time covered by each state. So this gives you sort of tells you how prominent each microstate is. Then we can look at the global explained variance of each state. That means, how well does my prototype map fit to the segmented maps? And we can also look at the average strength of activity by means of GFP. And another interesting thing is, we can look at the microstates as time series. So we can look at the probabilities that one microstate changes into another microstate. So we can calculate transition probabilities between states. So maybe you could ask yourself about the functional significance of each microstate. This is also a little bit difficult field, but they're sort of, the question is what produces microstates. I found like two possible answers to this: one improbable one and the more probable one. The improbable one would be that microstate is produced by small local groups of neurons that are active together. But this wouldn't be so helpful if it were the case, because then the meaning of each microstate would be something different. But this doesn't really make sense, because we've seen many, many studies that there's only a small number of microstates, and that they have a well-structured temporal dynamics, so that doesn't really make sense. The more probable cause of microstates or source of microstates is that they are sort of produced by large networks of activity that span a lot of the cortex, not just single areas. Then in the recent years, there have been quite some studies who try to connect microstates with resting fMRI. And they found that these microstates, that they are highly correlated to resting state fMRI networks. So it seems that this sort of corresponds to each other, even if it spans over it's a huge difference in the time scale. But there's also one study who actually showed how this relation between each microstates and slow resting state fMRI networks can happen via so-called scale-free dynamics. Well, now to the practice. We're going to use the EEG data of the children, actually the data Nicholas showed us. In my version, I filtered them from 2 to 20 hertz. He didn't do, but I just added another filter, so we will have the same data. It is pre-processed with automatic, and I don't know if you have... did you install the plugin yet? Nope. So you can download the MicroStation plugin from this GitHub link. It's also on
the tutorial page.
On the tutorial page. The link is also there. There's also uploaded sort of the script which we'll go through together.
Yeah,
to
the script.
On the brain hack.
On the brain hack? There's a...
Both the link to the script and the link to the GitHub repo should be on the tutorial page, if not.
Should I quickly show how to install the plugin? So you just download the plugin from this GitHub page. That's the page of Andreas Poulsen. And then you take the microstate 0.2 and you copy it. And I don't have. Does everybody have EEG lab installed?
Put this
Okay, we just try.
But can you go to the other?
So for those who have EGLab, just copy or paste the login into the problems folder.
Just the whole folder.
So you should have in the plugins folder, you should have microstate 0.2. I'm sorry, I think I really forgot to write that we need the EGLab toolbox, the EGLab.
Does it take long to
download?
No.
So do we need to download it?
EGLab. It shouldn't take too much. I think it's like half of a megabyte or something.
So you will find it if you Google EGLab download. And you go to the Schwartz Center for Computational Neuroscience. And there,
the very top.
There you click here. Yeah, and then you just put this, unzip this folder and put it anywhere where you'll find it again. Did this work for everybody? You need more time?
There is a Dropbox link inside the scripts, and I got an error.
From the drop? How about the...
Line 20?
Yeah. Sorry.
What
about
all the links? Did it work?
Yeah.
It's good there? Okay. Is it okay if I continue? Okay, then we can start MATLAB and open the microstate brainhacksignal.m file. That is also on the Git. So for this tutorial, we will only look at one subject. Normally, we're not so interested in single subjects, but I thought to make it easy, we look at one subject. The whole code can be easily modified with the loop to go through many subjects. Okay, so the first thing we have to do is we have to add the path of GLAB. So you have to change, make this bigger. So you have to change this here. And if this works, you can test it by running the line with EGLAB. Then EGLAB should open, as you see it here, with this nice blue window. We only need actually the functions of EGLAB. We're not using the GUI, so we close it again. And then we're gonna load a data set. And you can take the data set, you can take any subject which has been pre-processed by Nicholas. It's stored in a different folder than of course in my version here. And load the file, and because Nicholas hasn't applied a low pass filter and he only applied a high pass filter of 0.5 Hz, we're going to filter this data again. In microstates analysis, it's typically filtered between 1 and 40 Hz or 2 and 20 Hz, something like this. So we filter the data from 2 to 20 Hz. And after that, we will force an average reference. I'm not sure if it's necessary for microstate analysis, but I believe it's a good way or it's a good practice anyway to do average reference to use the average reference, because then it's sort of a neutral way of looking at the EG data and not using any reference, so yeah, it overcomes confusions later. So, as I shown before, we're gonna use the GFP peaks for the segmentation. So what we first do is we calculate the standard deviation of the EG data. I can show you the structure of the EG data, which is just quickly. As you see, the EEG data has 105 electrodes and 190,000 time points. So we're gonna do the standard deviation over the electrodes, and we have to change the data format because the next function doesn't like a signal as a variable time. So we do this. And we get a new variable, which is called GFP. And we can have a quick look at it. And this looks like over a couple of milliseconds. Here we have 500 hertz. So this is over the first 120 milliseconds is the GFP, and here you see the strength of activity over the time. And what we are looking for are peaks like these. And MATLAB has a function which is called find peaks. And it needs an input, like it needs a single vector, and it looks through the vector and searches for peaks. And you can tell this function also how much space between one and the next peak should be at minimum. You can visualize that later here. I selected 15 time frames between peaks. And we can just check in the first second, so the first 100 time frames, how this looks like. And here you see like these triangles, they show the selected peaks. And what we are actually really looking for are these peaks, but we don't really want, for example, this. And maybe here you would also find a small peak. So if we change this minimum distance to 1, we have to change it here. We'll also find peaks like this. So 15 time frames seems to be quite sensible to use. But you can check this with new data. It really depends on the filtering too. So then there are like two possibilities. We can either take all GFP peaks and do the segmentation, or if we have a lot of data, we sometimes have to make a selection of peaks. We don't want to just take the first 1,000 peaks because stuff can change over time. So we do we randomly select peaks, and for this we just create like a random selection vector, which are called selection. And with this we select out of the EEG data the first 1,000 peaks out of this rank. So these are not the first 1,000 peaks, these are just 1,000 peaks which are randomly sent. And this is also a good idea to, if you have many subjects, they typically don't have the same number of GFP peaks. So it's a good practice to just to take sort of the minimum number of peaks which are available for all subjects and randomly pick them through the subject. So now we are ready for the microstate segmentation. Just let this run. So the inputs are of course the EEG data, so we just have to give the EEG structure. This is like a typical EEG structure. Then we have to tell the function what kind of algorithm we use. We here use the modified k-means algorithm because we have spontaneous data and we don't want to account for polarity. And here we tell the function that we're looking for four clusters. And here that's, with this computer it's quite quick, and the segmentation is already done for four clusters in 1,000 maps, and the results are then stored in this out EG structure. And there we have like a new structure which is called microstate. And in this structure,
So you're for the simulation, you use the GFP, the GF peaks. Could you use any other information from, or is it common to use any other like synchronization between different sensors or the time difference between peaks? Just so it might give you different information about your data. Or if it's kind of common.
This is kind of the common method. And it is also like before these clustering methods have been used, like the first microstate analysis really looked from GFP peak to GFP peak and sort of said this is microstates were defined from GFP peak to GFP peak. So it is more or less the common thing. Maybe there are other indicators, but the idea is really to have like the to avoid noisy topographies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, of course, that gives you the strongest.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So what we see here in the output, here are like the options we give to the function, and the more sophisticated options too, which we haven't given, these are just defaults at the moment. And as probably the most important output, we get what is called scalp maps. So this would be the microstate topography or the microstate prototypes. This is given by four maps, because we've chosen four maps, and here again we have the 105 electrodes, and the four maps are in the columns. And we also have a labeling for each GFP peak. This is not so interesting because we're not interested sort of in how the segments are labeled for the moment. So we will get the same result, the same information in the backfit. Here in the results, microstate.res, we find some other information about the sort of the goodness of the solution. So these cell arrays up here, they have the, for one, they have the L is the labeling, the A is the microstate prototypes, and the Z is the microstate activation maps. That's difficult to explain. But we also have an indicator about explained variance, so an R-squared measure. And here we see we can explain 85% of the topography we've looked at. And we have some other information. Most of them can be used to select the optimal number of clusters. So we have this cross-validation criterion. We have a Kranovsky-Lie criterion, which only works if you have many different clusters. Okay. So what we need is we need this microstate scalp maps, so we need the microstate prototype maps, and I just store them in a new variable, and we can have a look at them, how they look like with this topo micro function. So for those who know EGLAB, this is like a modified topo plot function. And these are the four microstate prototypes. As I said before, there are like these typical four microstates. They look a little bit different than these, but here we really have we don't have much data. So if we would take many more subjects and put it all together, we get really close to the maps which have been found all the time. But they look reasonable. So what we don't want is maps with sort of with small clusters, because this indicates that single electrodes are still noisy. And this was actually the picture Nicholas showed was still noisy data when it is analyzed with the cluster cluster analysis. So then you have like the strongest maps are really noisy. So now we're actually finished with the segmentation. Like in the next step, we want to backfit these prototype maps to the actually to the same EEG data, but not only to the GFPPs. So we simply load this data set again. So we override the EEG structure. Then for now we're gonna skip this. So we're just gonna backfit the microstate template maps to the EEG, and we're gonna say that it has to be at minimum 15 time frames to be together. So in this algorithm, this really makes the microstate segments so this is to avoid these small pieces where the topographies change quickly. So we want clean microstate segments. Here we can also tell if we want to account for the polarity or not. And we can tell whether we want to have a sequentialized backfitting. This is only important for ERP data. So we set this to zero, or to when we try this pop edge pop maybe later, we have to turn this on. Okay. But here for now we say we don't want to sequentialize, put it to zero, and we run this. And now if we go to the EEG structure, EEG.microstate, we have a new structure which is called fit. And in this structure, again, we have like the information about the options of the function, and we have information about the labels. So in this function, we look which time frame belongs to which prototype. We get a best label over time. What we see here is that it starts with microstate 4, and this takes a while, and then it changes to microstate 3, for example. And this goes on over the whole time course of EEG. We also have the spatial correlation between the microstate maps and the time frames. And we can use this information later on for the statistics. So yeah, this is pretty much it, which is interesting. And now we're already almost finished. The last step we have to do is the microstate statistics. So we run this. And again, in the EEG microstate, a new structure should appear, which is called stats. And here we have like the output measures, which I showed before. So we have an average duration. We see that this is between 65 and 83 milliseconds, so it's a bit shorter than expected. We have indicators how often a microstate occurs within 1 second, and we also have indicators about the GFB, about the strength activity. And the last variable shows the transition probabilities. So here we see that with 43% of probability, microstate 1 changes into microstate 2. So from here on, we can check, for example, if we have different conditions, we can check these statistics for differences. So from here on, we're again free to do whatever we want. And we can also look at the seconds of some time. Now I've chosen to look at 1,000 time frames, and with this visual inspection, we see whether the microstates sort of look as they should look, more or less. And so these functions, they all work for like single trial data, so an ongoing EEG signal, but we can also use them. As I said before, with epoch data. So if we have many files of a subject, we can use these two. We can just rerun the EEG pop epoch down here until the end. And then it doesn't work. Now we have to turn on this sequentialized. This is still a bug. And then we get all the information in the stats, yeah?
Yeah, sorry, the epoch is the different frequency bands.
No, the epoch is... So if you look at the EEG data, and if you epoch it, like the experiment was resting state EEG, and these children, they had to keep their eyes open for a certain time, keep their eyes closed for a certain time. And this information is in this event structure. And if we do pop epoch EEG with the markers 20 and 30, that's what they call, then we get sort of we get epochs of EEG, and we can look at them separately. And in the end, we also get the statistics, which is quickly. Now we get, we have 12 epochs. Now we can look for every epoch, for example, look at the duration, whether it changed between conditions. So, are there any questions?
This doesn't take into account the frequency differences, or could you run this? I don't know, in terms of the microstates, you calculate them just from your signal, so you don't do, say, separation of frequencies, and then you, I don't know whether it's...
Of course you could filter your data in different frequencies
and then
do the microstates in different... I think there are even studies about this. Yeah, so that's it for the tutorial. So if you're interested in microstates, there are some really good papers. I would recommend these two papers, and there's also a nice book. It's not only about microstate analysis, it's more about just topographical analysis of the region. And if you have any questions later on, you can write me an email. And yeah, that's it.
Thank you.